This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Earthquake prediction is a branch of the science of seismology concerned with the specification of the time, location, and magnitude of future earthquakes within stated limits, and particularly the determination of parameters for the next strong earthquake to occur in a region. Earthquake prediction is sometimes distinguished from earthquake forecasting, which can be defined as the probabilistic assessment of general earthquake hazard, including the frequency and magnitude of damaging earthquakes in a given area over years or decades. Prediction can be further distinguished from earthquake warning systems, which upon detection of an earthquake, provide a real-time warning of seconds to neighboring regions that might be affected in the 1970s. Scientists were optimistic that a practical method for predicting earthquakes would soon be found, but by the 1990s, continuing failure led many to question whether it was even possible. Demonstrably successful predictions of large earthquakes have not occurred, and the few claims of success are controversial. Extensive searches have reported many possible earthquake precursors, but, so far, such precursors have not been reliably identified across significant spatial and temporal scales. While part of the scientific community hold that, taking into account non-seismic precursors and given enough resources to study them extensively, prediction might be possible, most scientists are pessimistic and some maintain that earthquake prediction is inherently impossible. Contents 1. Evaluating earthquake predictions 2. Difficulty or impossibility 3. Prediction methods 31. Precursors 311. Animal behavior 312. Changes in VP, versus 313. Radon emissions 314. Electromagnetic variations 3141. Van method 3142. Background magnetic field noise disturbances 32. Trends 321. Elastic rebound 322. Characteristic earthquakes 323. Seismic gaps 324. Seismicity patterns 4. Notable predictions 41. 1975, Haicheng, China. 42-1985-1993, Parkfield, U.S. Bakken Lind 43-1983-1995, Grease Van 44-2008, Grease Van 45-1989, Loma Prieta, U.S. 46-1990, New Madrid, U.S. Browning 47-2004. In many instances, however, the statistical nature of earthquake occurrence is not simply homogeneous. Clustering occurs in both space and time. In Southern California, about 6% of M30 earthquakes are followed by an earthquake of larger magnitude within 5 days and 10 kilometers. In central Italy, 95% of M30 earthquakes are followed by a larger event within 30. False alarms depends on the societal valuation of these outcomes. The rate of occurrence of both must be considered when evaluating any prediction method. In a 1997 study of the cost-benefit ratio of earthquake prediction research in Greece, Stathis Styros suggested that even a hypothetical excellent prediction method would be of questionable social utility, because organized evacuation of urban centers is unlikely to be successfully accomplished, while panic and other undesirable side effects can also be anticipated. He found that earthquakes kill less than 10 people per year in Greece on average, and that most of those fatalities occurred in large buildings with identifiable structural issues. Therefore, Styros stated that it would be much more cost-effective to focus efforts on identifying and upgrading unsafe buildings, since the death toll on Greek highways is more than 2,300 per year on average. He argued that more lives would also be saved if Greece's entire budget for earthquake prediction had been used for street and highway safety instead. Difficulty or impossibility. All predictions of the future can be to some extent successful by chance, malarja. Prediction of major earthquakes is impossible. However, these theories and their implication that earthquake prediction is intrinsically impossible have been disputed. Prediction methods. Earthquake prediction is an immature science. It has not yet led to a successful prediction of an earthquake. From first physical principles, research into methods of prediction therefore focus on empirical analysis, with two general approaches: either identifying distinctive precursors to earthquakes, or identifying some kind of geophysical trend or pattern in seismicity that might why precede a large earthquake. Precursor methods are pursued largely because of their potential utility for short-term earthquake prediction or forecasting, while trend methods are generally thought to be useful for forecasting, long-term prediction 10 to 100 years time scale or intermediate-term prediction 1 to 10 years time scale. Precursors. An earthquake precursor is an anomalous phenomenon that might give effective warning of an impending earthquake. Reports of these, though generally recognized as such only after the event, number in the thousands, some dating back to antiquity. There have been around 400 reports of possible precursors in scientific literature, of roughly 20 different types, running the gamut from aeronomy to zoology. None have been found to be reliable for the purposes of earthquake prediction. In the early 1990s, the IASPEI solicited nominations for a preliminary list of significant precursors. 40 nominations were made, of which 5 were selected as possible significant precursors, with 2 of those based on a single observation each. After a critical review of the scientific literature, the International Commission on Earthquake Forecasting for Civil Protection ICEF concluded in 2011 there was considerable room for methodological improvements in this type of research. In particular, many cases of reported precursors are contradictory, lack a measure of amplitude, or are generally unsuitable for a rigorous statistical evaluation. Published results are biased towards positive results, and so the rate of false negatives. Earthquake but no precursory signal is unclear. Seiya Aida has suggested that a significant problem is that the vast majority of seismic data gathering stations are sensitive only to seismic and geodetic data, and are not configured to detect geo-electromagnetic signals or other precursors. Therefore, the required data for comprehensive and definitive studies does not exist. Animal behavior. For centuries, there have been anecdotal accounts of anomalous animal behavior preceding and associated with earthquakes in cases where animals display unusual behavior some tens of seconds prior to a quake. It has been suggested they are responding to the P wave. These travel through the ground about twice as fast as the S waves that cause most severe shaking. They predict not the earthquake itself that has already happened, but only the imminent arrival of the more destructive S waves. It has also been suggested that unusual behavior hours or even days beforehand could be triggered by foreshock activity at magnitudes that most people do not notice. Another confounding factor of accounts of unusual phenomena is skewing due to flashbulb memories. Otherwise unremarkable details become more memorable and more significant when associated with an emotionally powerful event such as an earthquake. A study that attempted to control for these kinds of factors found an increase in unusual animal behavior possibly triggered by foreshocks in one case, but not in 4 other cases of seemingly similar earthquakes. Changes in VP, versus VP is the symbol for the velocity of a seismic P primary or pressure wave passing through rock, while versus is the symbol for the velocity of the S secondary or shear wave. Small-scale laboratory experiments have shown that the ratio of these two velocities, represented as VP, versus, changes when rock is near the point of fracturing. In the 1970s, it was considered a likely breakthrough when Russian seismologists reported observing such changes in the region of a subsequent earthquake. This effect, as well as other possible precursors, has been attributed to dilatancy, where rock stress to near its breaking point expands dilates slightly. Study of this phenomena near Blue Mountain Lake in New York State led to a successful prediction in 1973. However, additional successes have not followed, and it has been suggested that the prediction was a fluke. A VP versus anomaly was the basis of a 1976 prediction of AM 55-65 earthquake near Los Angeles, which failed to occur. Other studies relying on quarry blasts more precise and repeatable found no such variations, and an alternative explanation has been reported for such variations as have been observed. Geller 1997 noted that reports of significant velocity changes have ceased since about 1980. Radon emissions. Most rock contains small amounts of gases that can be isotopically distinguished from the normal atmospheric gases. There are reports of spikes in the concentrations of such gases prior to a major earthquake. This has been attributed to release due to pre-seismic stress or fracturing of the rock. One of these gases is radon, produced by radioactive decay of the trace amounts of uranium present in most rock. Radon is useful as a potential earthquake predictor because it is radioactive and thus easily detected, and its short half-life 38 days makes radon levels sensitive to short-term fluctuations. A 2009 review found 125 reports of changes in radon emissions prior to 86 earthquakes since 1966, but as the ICEF found in its review, the earthquakes with which these changes are supposedly linked were up to 1,000 kilometers away, months later, and at all. Magnitudes in some cases the anomalies were observed at a distant site, but not at closer sites. The ICEF found no significant correlation. Another review concluded that in some cases changes in radon levels preceded an earthquake, but a correlation is not yet firmly established. Electromagnetic variations. Various attempts have been made to identify possible pre-seismic indications in electrical, electric resistive, or magnetic phenomena. Van method. The Van method is named after the authors, P. Varatsos, K. Alexopoulos, and K. Namikos of the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens. In a 1981 paper, they claimed that by measuring ultra-low-frequency geoelectric voltages, what they called seismic electric signals (SES), they could predict earthquakes in 1980s. The Van team published more on their research, and in 1990s they claimed they were able to predict earthquakes larger than magnitude 5, within 100. The several hundred kilometers distances from the epicenter to the monitoring station. It was also claimed that Van's publications do not account for, i.e. identify and eliminate, possible sources of electromagnetic interference. ME taken as a whole, the Van method has been criticized as lacking consistency in the statistical testing of the validity of their hypotheses. In particular, there has been some contention regarding the catalog of actual seismic events to use in vetting predictions, and of the predicted magnitudes. A critical study found that, because of such ambiguities, a set of 22 claims of successful prediction by Van were actually 74% false, 9% correlated at random, and for 14% the correlation was uncertain. Two major reviews of Van appeared in 1996. Since 2001, the Van group has introduced a concept they call natural time, applied to the analysis of their precursors. Initially, it is applied on SES to distinguish them from noise and relate them to a possible impending earthquake. In case of verification classification as SES activity, natural time analysis is additionally applied to the general subsequent seismicity of the area associated with the SES activity. In order to improve the time parameter of the prediction, the method treats earthquake onset as a critical phenomenon. Background magnetic field noise disturbances. After the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake occurred, a group led by Anthony C. Fraser Smith of Stanford University reported that the event was preceded by disturbances in background magnetic field noise as measured by a sensor placed in Corralitos, California, about 45 miles 7. Statistical methods. These approaches also tend to be more probabilistic, and to have larger time periods, and so merge into earthquake forecasting. Elastic rebound. Even the stiffest of rock is not perfectly rigid given a large force such as between two immense tectonic plates moving past each other. The Earth's crust will bend or deform according to the elastic rebound theory of Reed, 1910. Eventually the deformation strain becomes great enough that something breaks, usually at an existing fault. Slippage along the break. An earthquake allows the rock on each side to rebound to a less deformed state. In the process, energy is released in various forms, including seismic waves, the cycle of tectonic force being accumulated in elastic deformation and released in a sudden rebound is then repeated as the displacement from a single earthquake ranges from less than a meter to around 10 meters for an M8 quake. The demonstrated existence of large strike slip displacements of hundreds of miles shows the existence of a long-running earthquake cycle. Characteristic earthquakes. The most studied earthquake faults such as the Nankai Megathrust, the Wasatch Fault, and the San Andreas Fault appear to have distinct segments. The characteristic earthquake model postulates that earthquakes are generally constrained within these segments as the lengths and other properties of the segments are fixed. Earthquakes that rupture the entire fault should have similar characteristics. These include the maximum magnitude, which is limited by the length of the rupture, and the amount of accumulated strain needed to rupture the fault segment, since continuous plate motions cause the strain to accumulate steadily. Seismic activity on a given segment should be dominated by earthquakes of similar characteristics that recur at somewhat regular intervals for a given fault segment. Identifying these characteristic earthquakes and timing their recurrence rate or conversely return period should therefore inform us about the next rupture. This is the approach generally used in forecasting seismic hazard. UCERF3 is a notable example of such a forecast. Prepared for the state of California, return periods are also used for forecasting other rare events, such as cyclones and floods, and assume that future frequency will be similar to observed frequency to date. The idea of characteristic earthquakes was the basis of the Parkfield prediction. Fairly similar earthquakes in 1857, 1881, 1901, 1922, 1933, 1934, and 1966 suggested a pattern of breaks every 219 years, with a standard deviation of plus or minus 31 years. Extrapolation from the 1966 event led to a prediction of an earthquake around 1988, or before 1993 at the latest at the 95% confidence interval. The appeal of such a method is that the prediction is derived entirely from the trend, which supposedly accounts for the unknown and possibly unknowable earthquake physics and fault parameters. However, in the Parkfield case, the predicted earthquake did not occur until 2004, a decade late. This seriously undercuts the claim that earthquakes at Parkfield are quasi-periodic, and suggests the individual events differ sufficiently in other respects to question whether they have distinct characteristics in common. Further research into the Parkfield seismic data revealed that several 40 earthquakes had reduced the stresses on the northwest portion of the Parkfield segment, causing it to skip generating the predicted 60 earthquake. The failure of the Parkfield prediction has raised doubt as to the validity of the characteristic earthquake model itself. Some studies have questioned the various assumptions, including the key one that earthquakes are constrained within segments, and suggested that the characteristic earthquakes may be an artifact of selection bias and the shortness of seismological records relative to earthquake cycles. Other studies have considered whether other factors need to be considered, such as the age of the fault, whether earthquake ruptures are more generally constrained within a segment as is often seen, or break past segment boundaries also seen, has a direct bearing on the degree of earthquake hazard. Earthquakes are larger where multiple segments break, but in relieving more strain they will happen less often. Seismic gaps at the contact where two tectonic plates slip past each other. Every section must eventually slip, as in the long term none get left behind, but they do not all slip at the same time. Different sections will be at different stages in the cycle of strain deformation accumulation and sudden rebound in the seismic gap model. The next big quake should be expected not in the segments where recent seismicity has relieved the strain, but in the intervening gaps where the unrelieved strain is the greatest. This model has an intuitive appeal. It is used in long-term forecasting, and was the basis of a series of circum-Pacific Pacific Rim forecasts in 1979 and 1989 to 1991. However, some underlying assumptions about seismic gaps are now known to be incorrect. A close examination suggests that there may be no information in seismic gaps about the time of occurrence or the magnitude of the next large event in the region. Statistical tests of the circum-Pacific forecast shows that the seismic gap model did not forecast large earthquakes well. Another study concluded that a long quiet period did not increase earthquake potential seismicity patterns. Various heuristically derived algorithms have been developed for predicting earthquakes. Probably the most widely known as the M8 family of algorithms, including the RTP method developed under the leadership of Vladimir Kalas Boric. M8 issues a time of increased probability tip alarm for a large earthquake of a specified magnitude upon observing certain patterns of smaller earthquakes. Tips generally cover large areas up to 1,000 kilometers across for up to 5 years. Such large parameters have made M8 controversial, as it is hard to determine whether any hits that happened were skillfully predicted, or only the result of chance. M8 gained considerable attention when the 2003 San Simeon and Hokkaido earthquakes occurred within a tip in 1999. Kalas Boric's group published a claim to have achieved statistically significant intermediate-term results using their M8 and MSC models. As far as worldwide large earthquakes are regarded, however, Geller et al. Are skeptical of prediction claims over any period shorter than 30 years. A widely publicized tip for an M64 quake in Southern California in 2004 was not fulfilled, nor two other lesser-known tips. A deep study of the RTP method in 2008 found that out of some 20 alarms, only two could be considered hits, and one of those had a 60% chance of happening anyway. It concluded that RTP is not significantly different from a naive method of guessing based on the historical rate seismicity, accelerating moment release AMR, moment being a measurement of seismic energy, also known as time to failure analysis, or accelerating seismic moment release ASMR, is based on observations that foreshock activity prior to a major earthquake not only increased, but increased at an exponential rate. In other words, a plot of the cumulative number of Foreshocks get steeper just before the main shock, following formulation by Bowman et al. 1998 into a testable hypothesis, and a number of positive reports. AMR seemed promising despite several problems. Known issues included not being detected for all locations and events, and the difficulty of projecting an accurate occurrence time when the tail end of the curve gets steep, but rigorous testing has shown that apparent AMR trends likely result from how data fitting is done, and failing to account for spatiotemporal clustering of earthquakes. The AMR trends are therefore statistically insignificant. Interest in AMR as judged by the number of peer-reviewed papers has fallen off since 2004. The occurrence of foreshocks has long been thought to be the most promising avenue in predicting earthquakes. A foreshock is a smaller earthquake that can strike minutes or days before a larger one, because the rupture process for the earthquakes is still not completely clear. Foreshock occurrence may give clues into an earthquake triggering process in the non-critical precursory accelerating seismicity theory NC past. Foreshocks happen because of the constant buildup of pressure along the fault lines. This theory is given weight due to seismic measurements. This had led to the conclusion for some scientists that foreshocks are a precursor to a larger event, and should be further studied and considered in earthquake prediction. Notable predictions. These are predictions, or claims of predictions, that are notable either scientifically or because of public notoriety, and claim a scientific or quasi-scientific basis, as many predictions are held confidentially, or published in obscure locations, and become notable only when they are claimed. There may be a selection bias in that hits get more attention than misses. The predictions listed here are discussed in Huff's book and Geller's paper 1975, Haicheng, China. The M73 1975 Haicheng earthquake is the most widely cited success of earthquake prediction. Study of seismic activity in the region led the Chinese authorities to issue a medium-term prediction in June 1974. The political authorities therefore ordered various measures taken, including enforced evacuation of homes, construction of simple outdoor structures, and showing of movies out of doors. The quake, striking at 19:36, was powerful enough to destroy or badly damage about half of the homes. However, the effective preventative measures taken were said to have kept the death toll under 300 in an area with population of about 16 million, where otherwise tens of thousands of fatalities might have been expected. However, although a major earthquake occurred, there has been some skepticism about the narrative of measures taken on the basis of a timely prediction. This event occurred during the Cultural Revolution, when belief in earthquake prediction was made an element of ideological orthodoxy that distinguished the true party-liners from right-wing deviationists. Recordkeeping was disordered, making it difficult to verify details, including whether there was any ordered evacuation. The method used for either the medium-term or short-term predictions other than Chairman Mao's revolutionary line has not been specified. The evacuation may have been spontaneous, following the strong M47 foreshock that occurred the day before. A 2006 study that had access to an extensive range of records found that the predictions were flawed. In particular, there was no of CIAL short-term prediction, although such a prediction was made by individual scientists. Also, it was the foreshocks alone that triggered the final decisions of warning and evacuation. They estimated that 2,041 lives were lost. That more did not die was attributed to a number of fortuitous circumstances, including earthquake education in the previous months prompted by elevated seismic activity, local initiative, timing occurring when people were neither working nor asleep, and local style of construction. The authors conclude that, while unsatisfactory as a prediction, it was an attempt to predict a major earthquake that for the RST time did not end up with practical failure. Further information: 1975 Haicheng earthquake, 1985-1993, Parkfield, U.S. Bakken Lind. The Parkfield earthquake prediction experiment was the most heralded scientific earthquake prediction ever. It was based on an observation that the Parkfield segment of the San Andreas Fault breaks regularly with a moderate earthquake of about M6 every several decades. 1857, 1881, 1901, 1922, 1934, and 1966 more particularly, Bakken. To have been successful, the prediction was unsuccessful in that the eventual event was a decade late. Further information: Parkfield earthquake 1983-1995, Greece. Van in 1981, the Van group, headed by Panayoti Varatsos, said that they found a relationship between earthquakes and seismic electric signals, SES. In 1984 they claimed there was a one-to-one correspondence between SES and earthquakes, that is, that every sizable EQ is preceded by an SES and inversely every every SES is always followed by an EQ, the magnitude and the epicenter of which can be reliably predicted, the SES appearing between 6 and 115 hours before the earthquake. See electromagnetic variations. Above as validation, they presented a table of 23 earthquakes from the 19th of January 1983 to the 19th of September 1983, of which they claimed to have successfully predicted 18 earthquakes. Their report was saluted by some as a major breakthrough, but was greeted by a wave of generalized skepticism among seismologists. Other lists followed, such as their 1991 claim of predicting 6 out of 7 earthquakes with MIS 55 in the period of 1 April 1987 through 10 August 1989, or 5 out of 7 earthquakes with MIS 53 in the overlapping period of 15 May 1988 to 10 August 1989. In 1996, they published a summary of all predictions issued from January 1, 1987 to June 15, 1995, amounting to 94 predictions, matching this against a list of all earthquakes with MSATH and within geographical bounds, including most of Greece. They come up with a list of 14 earthquakes they should have predicted. Here they claim 10 successes, for a success rate of 70%, but also a false alarm rate of 89%. The VAN predictions have been criticized on various grounds, including being geophysically implausible, vague and ambiguous, failing to satisfy prediction criteria, and retroactive adjustment of parameters. A critical review of 14 cases where VAN claimed 10 successes showed only one case where an earthquake occurred within the prediction parameters. The VAN predictions not only fail to do better than chance, but show a much better association with the events which occurred before them. According to Malarja and Gasparini, other early reviews found that the VAN results, when evaluated by definite parameters, were statistically significant. Both positive and negative views on VAN predictions from this period were summarized in the 1996 book A Critical Review of VAN, edited by Sir James Lighthill, and in a debate issue presented by the journal Geophysical Research Letters that was focused on the statistical significance of the VAN method. VAN had the opportunity to reply to their critics in those review publications in 2011. The ICEF reviewed the 1996 debate and concluded that the optimistic SES prediction capability claimed by VAN could not be validated. A crucial issue is the large and often indeterminate parameters of the predictions, such that some critics say these are not predictions, and should not be recognized as such. Much of the controversy with VAN arises from this failure to adequately specify these parameters. Some of their telegrams include predictions of two distinct earthquake events, such as typically one earthquake predicted at 300. Or even to issue public warnings. 2008, Greece VAN. After 2006, VAN claimed that all alarms related to SES activity have been made public by posting at archive.org. Such SES activity is evaluated using a new method they call natural time. One such report was posted on February 1, 2008, 2 weeks before the strongest earthquake in Greece during the period 1983-2011. This earthquake occurred on February 14, 2008, with magnitude MW69. VAN's report was also described in an article in the newspaper Ethnos on February 10, 2008. However, Gerasimos Papadopoulos complained that the VAN reports were confusing and ambiguous, and that none of the claims for successful VAN predictions is justified. 1989, Loma Prieta, U.S. The 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, epicenter in the Santa Cruz Mountains northwest of San Juan Bautista, California, caused significant damage in the San Francisco Bay Area of California. The U.S. Geological Survey USGS reportedly claimed, 12 hours after the event, that it had forecast this earthquake in a report the previous year. USGS staff subsequently claimed this quake had been anticipated. Various other claims of prediction have also been made. Harris 1998 reviewed 18 papers with 26 forecasts dating from 1910 that variously offer or relate to scientific forecasts of the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake. In this case, no distinction is made between a forecast, which is limited to a probabilistic estimate of an earthquake happening over some time period, and a more specific prediction. None of these forecasts can be rigorously tested due to lack of specificity, and where a forecast does bracket the correct time and location, the window was so broad, e.g., covering the greater part of California for 5 years, as to lose any value as a prediction. Predictions that came close but given a probability of only 30% had 10 or 20 year windows. One debate dated prediction came from the M8 algorithm used by Kalas Borok and associates in four forecasts. The first of these forecasts missed both magnitude M75 and time, a five-year window from 1 January 1984, to 31 December 1988. They did get the location, by including most of California and half of Nevada. A subsequent revision, presented to the NEPEC, extended the time window to 1 July 1992, and reduced the location to only Central California. The magnitude remained the same. A figure they presented had two more revisions. For M70 quakes in Central California, the five-year time window for one ended in July 1989, and so missed the Loma Prieta event. The second revision extended to 1990, and so included Loma Prieta when discussing success or failure of prediction for the Loma Prieta earthquake. Some scientists argue that it did not occur on the San Andreas Fault, the focus of most of the forecasts, and involved dip-slip vertical movement rather than strike-slip horizontal movement, and so was not predicted. Other scientists argue that it did occur in the San Andreas Fault Zone, and released much of the strain accumulated since the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. Therefore, several of the forecasts were correct. Huff states that most seismologists do not believe this quake was predicted per se. In a strict sense, there were no predictions, only forecasts, which were only partially successful. IBEN Browning claimed to have predicted the Loma Prieta event, but as will be seen in the next section, this claim has been rejected. Further information, 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, 1990, New Madrid, U.S. Browning. Further information, tidal triggering of earthquakes. Dr. IBEN Browning, a scientist with a PhD degree in zoology and training as a biophysicist, but no experience in geology, geophysics, or seismology, was an independent business consultant who forecast long-term climate trends for businesses. He supported the idea, scientifically unproven, that volcanoes and earthquakes are more likely to be triggered when the tidal force of the Sun and the Moon coincide to exert maximum stress on the Earth's crust. Syzygy having calculated when these tidal forces maximize, Browning then projected what areas were most at risk for a large earthquake. An area he mentioned frequently was the New Madrid seismic zone at the southeast corner of the state of Missouri, the site of three very large earthquakes in 1811-12, which he coupled with the date of 3 December 1990. Browning's reputation and perceived credibility were boosted when he claimed in various promotional flyers and advertisements to have predicted, among various other events, the Loma Prieta earthquake of 17 October 1989. The National Earthquake Prediction Evaluation Council, NEPEC, formed an ad hoc working group, AHWG, to evaluate Browning's prediction. Its report, issued 18 October 1990, specifically rejected the claim of a successful prediction of the Loma Prieta earthquake. A transcript of his talk in San Francisco on 10 October showed he had said, "There will probably be several earthquakes around the world, Richter 6, and there may be a volcano or two, which, on a global scale, is about average for a week," with no mention of any earthquake in California, though the AHWG report disproved both Browning's claims of prior success and the basis of his projection. It made little impact after a year of continued claims of a successful prediction. Browning's prediction received the support of geophysicist David Stewart, and the tacit endorsement of many public authorities in their preparations for a major disaster, all of which was amplified by massive exposure in the news media. Nothing happened on 3 December, and Browning died of a heart attack 7 months later, 2004. The M8 algorithm, developed under the leadership of Dr. Vladimir Kalas Borok at UCLA, gained respect by the apparently successful predictions of the 2003 San Simeon and Hokkaido earthquakes. Great interest was therefore generated by the prediction in early 2004 of a M64 earthquake to occur somewhere within an area of Southern California of approximately 12,000 square miles, on or before 5 September 2004. In evaluating this prediction, the California Earthquake Prediction Evaluation Council, CEPEC, noted that this method had not yet made enough predictions for statistical validation, and was sensitive to input assumptions. It therefore concluded that no special public policy actions were warranted, though it reminded all Californians of the significant seismic hazards throughout the state. The predicted earthquake did not occur. A very similar prediction was made for an earthquake on or before 14 August 2005, in approximately the same area of Southern California. The CEPEC's evaluation and recommendation were essentially the same, this time noting that the previous prediction and two others had not been fulfilled. This prediction also failed. 2009, L'Aquila, Italy. Giuliani main article, 2009 L'Aquila earthquake at 3:32 on 6 April 2009, the Abruzzo region of central Italy was rocked by a magnitude M63 earthquake in the city of L'Aquila and surrounding area. Around 60,000 buildings collapsed or were seriously damaged, resulting in 308 deaths and 67,500 people left homeless around the same time. It was reported that Giampaolo Giuliani had predicted the earthquake, had tried to warn the public, but had been muzzled by the Italian government. Giampaolo Giuliani was a laboratory technician at the Laboratori Nazionali del Gran Sasso. As a hobby, he had for some years been monitoring radon using instruments he had designed and built prior to the L'Aquila earthquake. He was unknown to the scientific community, and had not published any scientific work. He had been interviewed on 24 March by an Italian language blog, Dun Democratice, about a swarm of low-level earthquakes in the Abruzzo region that had started the previous December. He said that this swarm was normal and would diminish by the end of March. On 30 March, L'Aquila was struck by a magnitude 40 tremor, the largest to date. On 27 March, Giuliani warned the mayor of L'Aquila there could be an earthquake within 24 hours, and an earthquake M approximately 23 occurred on 29 March. He made a second prediction. He telephoned the mayor of the town of Sulmona, about 55 kilometers southeast of L'Aquila, to expect a damaging or even catastrophic earthquake within 6 to 24 hours. Loudspeaker vans were used to warn the inhabitants of Sulmona to evacuate, with consequential panic. No quake ensued, and Giuliano was cited for inciting public alarm and enjoined from making future public predictions. After the L'Aquila event, Giuliani claimed that he had found alarming rises in radon levels just hours before. He said he had warned relatives, friends and colleagues on the evening before the earthquake hit. He was subsequently interviewed by the International Commission on Earthquake Forecasting for Civil Protection, which found that Giuliani had not transmitted a valid prediction of the mainshock to the civil authorities before its occurrence. See also 2008 California Earthquake Study. Binary Classification. California Earthquake Forecast Classification Rule. Coordinating Committee for Earthquake Prediction, Japan Earthquake Engineering. Earthquake Weather Forecasting. National Earthquake Prediction Evaluation Council. Ring of Fire. Seismo Electromagnetic Supermoon. Type 1 and Type 2 Errors. Notes. Carat Geller et al. 1997, p. Carat e.g., the most famous claim of a successful prediction is that alleged for the 1975 Haichung Earthquake. ICEF 2011, p. Carat. The manslaughter convictions against the seven scientists and technicians in Italy are not for failing to predict the L'Aquila earthquake, where some 300 people died, as for giving undue assurance to the populace. One victim called it anesthetizing. That there would not be a serious earthquake, and therefore no need to take precautions. Hall 2011, Cartledge 2011. Additional details in Cartledge 2012. Carat. It has been reported that members of the Chinese Academy of Sciences were purged for having ignored scientific predictions of the disastrous Tangshan earthquake of summer 1976. Wade 1977. Carat. In January 1999, there was a report, Segusa 1999, that China was introducing tough regulations intended to stamp out false earthquake warnings, in order to prevent panic and mass evacuation of cities triggered by forecasts of major tremors. This was prompted by more than 30 unofficial earthquake warnings in the past 3 years, none of which has been accurate. Carat Geller 1997, Section 52, p. 437. Carat Atwood. Communications from the authorities. Maletti. Carat Rikitaki 1979, p. Carat Hammond 1973. Additional references in Geller 1997, Section 24. Carat Scholes, Sykes. Carat Verazzos. Carat Verazzos, Sarlis.